break to register if you hadn't registered yet. But let me think, I'm thinking about it now, so let me remind you if you haven't registered that they need you to do that. And then let me introduce our next speaker, Nalini Anantharaman, who will talk about quantum chaos.
Okay, thank you very much for the invitation to this workshop. In these two lectures, I'll try to introduce the topic of quantum chaos. So today, I'll start. The main objective is to, at least at the beginning, I'll try to explain what are the three main conjectures in quantum chaos, and I will give a historical background for this. Then I will focus on the question of delocalization of eigenfunctions and the quantum ergodicity theorem. And at the end of this lecture, I will also mention, discuss in more detail the quantum unique ergodicity conjecture. And tomorrow, my plan is to give a blackboard talk to give the proof of the Schnirelmann theorem, the quantum ergodicity theorem. And for that, I will need pseudo-differential operators. I was planning to give a reminder, but I will see how to articulate it with your talk. So let's start with some history. So obviously, from the name, quantum chaos is related to quantum mechanics. So let's start with some early quantum mechanics. So this is at the beginning of the 20th century. The main problem in quantum mechanics was to explain the spectrum of the atoms, the discrete spectrum of the atoms. So the fact that atoms can emit or absorb only certain frequencies of light that form a discrete set. So for instance, this is the part of the spectrum of the hydrogen atom. And to do that, in 1913, Niels Bohr introduced his model of the hydrogen atom. So it's mostly a classical model. So you start with the classical Coulomb description of the atom, where you have a nucleus and one electron that gravitates. It's called also the planetary model of the atom. But to this classical description, you add what is called a quantization rule. So you add, it's a kind of postulate, if you want, you add the rule that the kinetic momentum can only take a discrete set of values. So the kinetic momentum should be an integer multiple of the Planck constant. So if you add this rule, you find that the energies that the electron can have can only take a discrete set of values, and this is how Bohr managed to explain the discrete spectrum of the hydrogen atom. And it fitted very well with the experimental data. So that was for the first atom of the list, the hydrogen, and of course then the next question was to try to find similar quantization rules for larger atoms, or more generally for Hamiltonian systems with a larger number of degrees of freedom. In 1917, Einstein wrote a paper on the subject. It's a theoretical paper. It's mostly a mathematical paper. And the goal of the paper is to find general quantization rules for general Hamiltonian systems. So that is what he does, and he notices, so this is just a small remark in the paper, so the translation in English, he notices that the rules that he has found only make sense under very specific conditions that now we would phrase as saying that the system is completely integrable. Because his quantization rules are that a certain number of variables called action variables should be an integer multiple of the Planck constant. So he makes this remark that if the system is not completely integrable, he doesn't know how to formulate quantization rules. More precisely, he says, so type B here means not completely integrable, and he says that, in particular, classical statistical mechanics deals essentially only with type B, because in this case, the microcanonic ensemble of one system is equivalent to the time ensemble. So nowadays, we would say that this is the ergodicity property. And what he says here, and I will give more definitions later, but what he says here is that for an ergodic system, he doesn't know what the quantization rules should look like. So he's asking about the spectrum of an ergodic classical system. And this could be seen at the starting point of quantum chaos, if one wants. To be honest, I don't really know if people who started to work on quantum chaos in the 80s were motivated by this paper or not. Probably they had other motivations, but still it's nice to see that one can find this remark in such an early paper of quantum mechanics. So then, during a few years, people in quantum mechanics tried very hard to find quantization rules for the helium atom. So it's two electrons. And they failed. So they tried to start from the classical description and to find quantization rules, but they couldn't. And at some point, they decided that maybe one should start with completely new rules for mechanics. So Heisenberg decided to just postulate some new physical rules. And so Heisenberg's physics is based on a few principles. One of the first principles is that the physical observables should be represented by operators, matrices or operators. And matrices, as you know, don't commute. There are certain commutation relations. And he manages to explain the quantum effects by this non-commutativity of operators. In particular, if you in Heisenberg mechanics, if you want to compute the spectrum of a system, you should be able to build the operator related to describing the energy, and then you should be able to compute the eigenvalues of this operator. So it is here that the notion of eigenvalues and spectrum merge in the history of physics and mathematics. Parallel to that, there is another theory, which is the theory of Schrödinger, motivated by the idea of De Broglie, of wave-particle duality. It's a completely different, apparently it's a completely different theory. So the idea is that instead of thinking of electrons as particles, they can also behave as waves. So they are both particles and waves. And a wave is described by a function, so a function psi called the wave function. It's a function of position. So here in three dimension is x, y, z, and time. And what Schrödinger did is to give the fundamental equation of evolution for wave functions. So this equation here replaces the Newton law in mechanics. And the Schrödinger equation is as follows. It's a PDE. It's a linear PDE that I times the Planck constant times d psi over dt is equal to a certain operator, linear operator, applied to psi. And this operator, in the case of an atom, so there is the Laplacian, which represents the kinetic energy, and the potential V, which in our case would be the Coulomb potential, the potential V. So we see that we have two different theories for quantum mechanics, but it was realized shortly afterwards that from a mathematical point of view, they are equivalent. In both cases, you must diagonalize some operator, and it was shown that for the hydrogen atom and for other atoms, they give the two theories give the same spectrum. However, in the Schrödinger picture, there is an object called the wave function that doesn't exist, that is not present in the Heisenberg theory. And in this talk, the wave function will be the main object of study. So now we are in the 50s. The physicist Wigner was trying to describe the spectrum of nuclei of very heavy atoms, and he decided that it's too complicated to try to effectively solve the Schrödinger equation because it's a too complicated system, and that maybe one should be more lazy in some sense and just say that because it's a very complex system of high number of degrees of freedom, one should just say that it's that the operator that we have to diagonalize is like a large random matrix. what Wigner did is to introduce some random matrix models, and this numerical simulation is from a paper by Bohigas. You can compare. So here, this histogram here is the statistics of gaps between eigenvalues in the spectrum of heavy nuclei. So they are measured experimentally. And the smooth curve is the Wigner prediction, so coming from the random matrix model. And you can see that it fits rather well. Here, the Poisson curve is just to show that it doesn't fit at all with the Poisson process. In the 80s, people also started to do numerical simulations, and they discovered something that might seem surprising, that the Wigner model also seems to fit quite well with certain systems with a low number of degrees of freedom. And this can be surprising because Wigner's idea was to introduce his model for very complicated systems, but it seems to fit also with certain rather simple systems. So this picture here is a numerical simulation done on a computer for the hydrogen atom in a strong magnetic field. And again, the statistics of gaps in the spectrum seems to fit well with the Wigner model. And what people also did is to do numerical simulation on billiards. So it's maybe getting a little away from quantum mechanics, but it's billiards are nice for numerical simulation. So what is a billiard? So you have a domain in R2, let's say, or in Rn, and we consider the motion of a particle in this domain. The particle is submitted to no force, so it moves, the position x moves in straight line, and the momentum is conserved, but when the particle hits the boundary, it is reflected. So it gives rise to a dynamical system called a billiard flow. And from the point of view of quantum mechanics, one should consider this should be replaced by the Schrödinger equation, where the potential is zero because there is no force, but you put a boundary condition for your wave function. So when we talk about a billiard in quantum mechanics, it simply means that we are considering the unitary flow generated by the Laplacian with a given boundary condition. So these numerical simulations are simply for eigenvalues of the Laplacian in a domain. And what is seen is that the statistics depends a lot on the shape of the domain. So here on the left, it's a numerical simulation for a circle. So the billiard is just a circular billiard. And the statistics seems to fit quite well with the Poisson process. In the middle, we have the famous stadium billiard. So it's a rectangle with two half circles that we will see again many times in this talk. And for this stadium billiard, the statistics of eigenvalues fits quite well with the Wigner model. And then you can consider more complicated billiards. So here, this is a stadium, but where you have slightly modified the boundary. And for this one, you get another statistic that is not very well identified. But the main idea that people have is that one should be able to classify Hamiltonian systems in various families. For certain families, you should see a Poisson statistic. For other families, you should see the Wigner statistics. And for more complicated geometries, you see more complete. But the idea is to try just to classify Hamiltonian systems into universality classes. So now, let me give the three main conjectures in quantum chaos. The first one is about the statistics of the spectrum. What is observed experimentally is that if you start with a with ergodic or sufficiently chaotic billiard, it seems that the spectrum of the quantum system will always look like the spectrum of a large random matrix. And this is called the Bohigas-Giannoni-Schmidt conjecture. And it's fully open at the moment, so I won't say much more about it. And it's actually even known to be false for certain chaotic systems, so it needs to be clarified. The second conjecture is the one I will spend most of my time on. It's about the wave function. So you consider the Schrödinger equation. Either you consider the time-dependent equation and you consider the evolution over a large time, or you consider a stationary solution, so an eigenfunction of the Schrödinger operator. And the belief is that if you start with a sufficiently chaotic system, and with the wave function, what you do is to take psi of x squared. In quantum mechanics, this is supposed to represent the probability of finding the particle at point x when you make a measurement. And it is expected that for a chaotic system, this probability should be close to the uniform probability. This is called the quantum unique ergodicity conjecture, and I will discuss it more in what follows. And then the third conjecture is called the Berry conjecture. So now you still consider the wave function, so let's say an eigenfunction of the Schrödinger operator, and it says that this eigenfunction, if you restrict it to a ball of size, a large number of times the wavelength, it should, in some sense, look like a Gaussian process. And again, this formulation is a bit vague, and part of the question is to try to give a precise mathematical meaning to this. Also, something that should be clarified is that all these conjectures are meant to hold in the semi-classical limit. So there is a parameter h, which is going to zero, which is the Planck constant. According to the quantum classical correspondence, when Planck constant goes to zero, quantum mechanics could converge to classical mechanics. And you see that saying that h goes to zero in some sense means that we are considering the limit of where the wavelength goes to zero. Because if you consider an eigenfunction of the Schrödinger operator, by integration by parts, you will find that the gradient of psi is of order square root of 2me, so a constant over h. So h goes to zero means that we are considering very rapidly oscillating functions. And for instance, maybe I want to clarify a little what is meant in the Berry conjecture, so the last one, because I won't discuss it because nothing is known, but just I want to clarify what is meant. So you pick a point h0, let's say in your billiard, for instance, or and you look around this point, you look at a ball which is of size, a fixed, so R is a fixed number but large. So you look at a ball that is small, going to zero, but that is of size a large number of times the wavelength. And you want to consider your eigenfunction restricted to this ball. Okay, so you do a zoom. To identify this with a ball of radius r in rd, so you do a zoom of 1 over h bar. So now you get a function on rd on a ball of fixed size, r, and you want to say that the function that you get here looks like a random Gaussian function. And still, if I say it this way, it's not very clear what it means, because here I started with a deterministic function, and it's not clear what it means that this deterministic function should look like a random function. So In the last year, there has been just some little mathematical activity on the subject, and in particular, there is a recent paper by Abbott, Bergeron, and Lemasson that clarifies what, that gives a meaning to this. It means that if we pick, if we pick a point at random, so although the function here is deterministic, we look at it around a randomly chosen point. And then when we do this identification, there is also some randomness involved because to identify with the ball in RD, we need to choose some coordinate frame, and we also do it randomly. So this identification is also random. So starting from a deterministic function, we get a random function, and the precise meaning of the conjecture is maybe that this random function in distribution looks like a Gaussian function. Okay, so now let me focus on the question, on the second question, so the question of delocalization of eigenfunctions. So we start with a billiard table, so which is a domain in R2, or more generally, we want to consider a compact Riemannian manifold, and the dimension here will be denoted by D. On a billiard table, I already defined the billiard flow, which is motion in straight line. So it's the motion of a particle submitted to no force. More generally, if I am on a Riemannian manifold, if I have a particle that is submitted to no force, it moves with zero acceleration, and this is called, so it moves along geodesic. So this is called the geodesic flow. So what replaces the billiard flow on a compact Riemannian manifold is the geodesic flow, the motion with zero acceleration. Again, from the quantum point of view, we are considering the Schrödinger equation, which is just the unitary flow generated by the Laplacian. And if we consider the stationary equation, actually, I'm just considering eigenfunctions of the Laplacian. So let me show a few pictures so that you can form an idea of the kind of questions that people are wondering about. So this is the case of a circular billiard. So you see, so in red, you see a few trajectories of the billiard. You see that it's quite simple. And in green are a few eigenfunctions of the Laplacian with directly boundary conditions. So if you prefer manifolds, this is the sphere. These are a few spherical harmonics on the sphere. And an even simpler case is the case of a square. So here you have just quite a very basic representation of the Fourier modes on a square. So you see that these three examples look rather uninteresting. And these three examples are completely integrable systems. When completely integrable system precisely means that if I choose the right coordinates, I can write everything explicitly. I have an explicit formula for the classical dynamics and for the eigenfunctions of the Laplacian. Actually, I'm a bit. There are many recent interesting papers on completely integrable systems, so I don't want to. What I want to say is that this is not the kind of system that we are going to consider here. Completely integrable means that you can write many things explicitly. Okay. On the other hand, a system that has been studied a lot and that is not completely integrable is this stadium billiard. So this is an old picture by Eric Heller and a more recent one by Arne Baker. Maybe I should stress the fact that although this geometry is very simple, there is no way of writing down explicitly the trajectories of the billiard and the eigenfunctions. So the only thing that one can do is either numerical simulations or proving general theorems without having formulas. So here you can see 40 consecutive eigenfunctions of the Laplacian on this circular billiard. and on this stadium billiard, and we will discuss them more in the rest of the talk. You see that depending on the frequency, the patterns that you see are quite diverse. I also show some. So this is a mushroom-shaped billiard, or just half of a mushroom. So here the billiard is, you have a half disc and a square. So some of the trajectories just see the half disc, and some of the trajectories go also in the square and have a more complicated behavior. And this is also reflected in the eigenfunctions of the Laplacian. Some of them just look like eigenfunctions in a disc, and some of them have a more complicated behavior. And although I'm only going to focus on the stationary solutions, maybe let me show a movie of the evolution equation. Let's see if I find it. Yeah, it's here. So here we are going to see a solution of the Schrödinger equation in a billiard that is, it's a cardioid, or it's half of a cardioid, so it's also a chaotic billiard, and we start from an initial condition, which is a Gaussian wave packet. It's a movie done, again, by Arndt Becker. So you see that it bounces on the boundary, but after some time, there are some more complicated effects taking place. And if you wait for a very long time, then it becomes what we call delocalized, because it seems more or less uniform. And it seems to stay like this forever. Or, well, we don't know what happens for infinite time, but. Okay, so let me discuss now some results on the delocalization of eigenfunctions. We would like to say that if we have a chaotic billiard, or if we have a chaotic geodesic flow, then I consider an eigenfunction of the Laplacian, we would like to say that psi of x is almost uniform. Maybe for large frequencies, so maybe for lambda goes to infinity. So what are the ways to measure this? So maybe first let's discuss the meaning of the word chaotic. So actually in mathematics, chaotic doesn't have a precise, rigorous definition. It's good for scientific journalists. They like the word a lot. But there is no precise definition. So here, when I say chaotic, in the rest of the talk, I will have in mind maybe the best understood form of chaos, which is what people call uniformly hyperbolic systems, or this is synonymous to Anosov dynamics. And let me try to say what this means. So as I wrote, the prototype of a chaotic billiard in this sense will be a billiard with a piecewise concave boundary. And it can have also convex obstacles, but from the outside, it's a concave obstacle. And if you prefer manifolds, the prototype of a chaotic geodesic flow will be manifolds of negative curvature. And what does it mean? So let's look. Let's try to do a picture. So for instance, if I have a concave boundary, if I send a few trajectories that are parallel like that, what happens after one reflection? They will become divergent. Okay, so if you send some parallel rays, after one reflection, they will diverge, and then the more, if you do a second reflection, they will diverge even more. And if you wait, you can imagine that if you do many reflections, they will diverge exponentially fast. But this should be precise because my billiard is compact, it doesn't really mean anything to say that the distance between trajectories diverges. So the precise definition that I want is to consider infinitesimal variations of the initial condition. So I start here with one initial condition, which is a position and a momentum. And let's say that I will always take the momentum to be one. And I do an infinitesimal variation of this initial condition. So I vary a little the position, and I vary slightly the momentum. The property that I want that holds for concave billiard is that, so again, if I want an infinitesimal definition, I have to take the differential of the flow applied to the infinitesimal variation. And this will diverge exponentially fast. Either when t goes to plus infinity or when it goes to minus infinity. More precisely, let me give the precise definition of uniformly hyperbolic, although I won't really need it in the talk, but just to have a precise definition of what I have in mind. So hyperbolic dynamics means the following, that if for every initial condition, I can decompose. So the set of infinitesimal deformation is so RD for the position and the tangent space to the sphere for the momentum, because I said that I want my momentum to stay on a sphere. So this is the space of infinitesimal deformations. Hyperbolic means that I can decompose this space as a direct sum of three subspaces. So this is called the unstable subspace. This is called the stable subspace. And this, actually, here I forgot to say something. This is for, there is a trivial deformation of the trajectory, which would be, there is one trivial deformation to be avoided, which is the variation where I just move along the direction of the flow. Because if I just do a deformation in this direction, then the trajectory is unchanged, and this property cannot hold. So W0 is just the trivial deformation, so the direction of the flow in which nothing happens. This is the trivial deformation. And then there is this unstable subspace that have the property that if I do a deformation of the initial condition in the stable direction, I will have that the variation of the flow trajectory so decays exponentially when t goes to plus infinity. And thus, to make the connection with what I wrote here, it will grow exponentially when t goes to minus infinity. So this is the stable direction, and the unstable one are the same properties, but it's changing plus and minus infinity. So this is what is called the hyperbolic property for a dynamical system, and uniformly here means that that it's nice in the sense that C and alpha are uniform. So uniformly means that the constants here are uniform. And the decomposition depends continuously on the initial condition. So it's somehow uniformly hyperbolic means the nicest form of chaos. And so it's the case for concave billiards, but billiards are still not the simplest case because for billiards, you have some problem with the boundary. So you have to avoid the set of measures zero of trajectories. So billiards are not yet the simplest case. It's even better to work with things that don't have a boundary. It's also the same for certain problems in PDE, that the boundary is a cause of complications. Here it's the same. So really, the simplest example that people like to work with is manifolds without boundary and with negative curvature, for which you have a similar hyperbolic property. But I won't need this in what follows. It's just to try to give a precise meaning to the word chaos. So let's go back to our question of understanding what it means that psi of h is close to uniform. Maybe one way of measuring this is just to consider the L infinity norm of the eigenfunctions. Okay, so here psi lambda in this slide is a solution of Laplacian psi equals to minus lambda psi. So if it was really uniform, then it would the L infinity norm of the I forgot to say, and this is important, it's simple but important, that I always normalize my eigenfunctions to have norm 1 in L2. I consider compact manifolds, and I always normalized to them to have L2 norm equal to 1. So one way that we can think of measuring of comparing this distribution to the uniform is maybe to look at the L infinity norm. And here on these slides, what I wrote at the top is the famous Hermander bound, which is very general, that holds on any compact manifold, that for any eigenfunction, we can write that the L infinity norm has a general bound in terms of the frequency. That is lambda to the d minus 1 over 4. And below, it's a generalization to LP norms that is due to SOG, but I don't really want to discuss it here. So this is a general bound on any manifold, and it's known to be optimal for the sphere. For the sphere, the Hermander bound is attained, and for the L infinity norm, it's attained for... So these are the usual spherical harmonics that have... So there are eigenfunctions of the Laplacian that have an additional symmetry around the vertical axis. And in particular, this is an eigenfunction of the Laplacian that is radially invariant. And this one when lambda goes to infinity, achieves the Hermander bound. It's an eigenfunction that is very large at the north and the south pole. So one can wonder if the sphere is the only one, is the only manifold achieving the Hermander bound. And our goal would be to say that if we are on a manifold, so this is positive curvature. The hope would be that if we are in negative curvature, so if we are in the case of a chaotic dynamics, one should be able to do much better than the Hermander bound. Chris Sugg and Steve Zeldich have worked a lot on this question, and they have a kind of partial converse to the Hermander bound. Let's see. And all this, I'm not going to give any proof of it, but this uses a lot of microlocal, this is really a lot of microlocal analysis involved. So let me make a picture to illustrate what is written on this slide. The sphere is very special because special property of the sphere is that the geodesics are all periodic. So the geodesics of a sphere are just the equators, so they are closed curve. And here, what Sugg and Zeldich prove is that if the Hermander bound is achieved, then there must be many points with closed geodesics. So if we have a point x, we will consider the set of vectors for which the geodesic that is issued from in the direction v comes back to x. This is called Lx in the slide. And what Sugg and Zeldich proved is that if we are on a manifold such that the Hermander bound is achieved, so if there is a sequence of eigenvalues satisfying the Hermander bound for which it's sharp, then there must exist a point x for which there is a set of positive measure of directions v that come back to x. So there must be a kind of an analog of the north pole of the sphere. And in the real analytic case, that can somehow say more. So what does it tell us about negative curvature? So if we are in negative curvature, it is known that for every x, the set of directions that come back to x has zero measure. So in particular, what the result says is that in negative curvature, we must have that psi lambda. So the Hermander bound cannot be sharp. So the norm of psi lambda, the L infinity norm, must be little o of lambda d minus 1 over 4, which already tells us something, but it's quite weak. So we would like to know more. And everybody believes that in negative curvature, one should really be able to do much more than the little o. But unfortunately, despite a lot of great and difficult work, people are not able to go very far. Basically, the main improvements is by adding. So people manage to get an improvement by 1 over square root of log lambda. And note also, so this is in, note also, so I'm maybe not going to read all this, but it was first proven by Berard, who assumed non-positive curvature, but actually, for instance, what Yannick Bontono proved is that in any dimension, this improvement only assumes, we only need to assume that there are no conjugate points. So this improvement of the Hermander bound, first, it's not very satisfactory because it's only by a log, and also it doesn't really have much to do with chaos. It's more related to absence of conjugate point for the geodesic flow. So it's true even if there are places of zero curvature. Yes? for the geodesic flow. It's a point where the differential of the exponential function is not injective. So you can have two. You can have two directions that. So it's an infinitesimal version of having two vectors starting at the same point and coming back later. So this is not. So yeah, basically this is the best that people manage to do. So it's not really going in the direction that really of saying that if the geodesic flow is chaotic, then psi should the eigenfunctions of the Laplacian should be close to uniform. So let's turn to another way of seeing things that is called quantum ergodicity. So now here I was considering the L infinity norm, so individual values of the eigenfunction. But now we want to consider the probability measure of density psi k of h squared. Okay, and we want to know if this probability measure is close to the uniform measure. It's a weaker topology. I want to know if I take a test function A and integrate it against psi of h squared times the volume, I want to know if this is close to the uniform average of A. And here is what is called the Schneeermann theorem or quantum ergodicity theorem that I'm going to discuss more, I'm going to give the proof tomorrow. So assume that the geodesic flow is ergodic, and I will have to give the definition of that. Then, if I take a test function and I compare the two averages, and I do, so now I average all this over all eigenvalues of the Laplacian less than lambda. Maybe I should say that because I am on a compact manifold, the spectrum of the Laplacian is discrete. So I average all these quantities over all eigenvalues less than lambda. N of lambda here is just the number of terms in the sum. And I put an absolute value here. Then this quantity goes to zero in the limit of large frequencies. One important point really here is are the eigenvalues. So if I write the same without the eigenvalues, it's true, but it's a very general thing about on all Riemannian manifolds. So without the absolute value, this is always true. So here really it's important to have these absolute values. So what and what does the theorem say? You see, it's a kind of, I don't know, Cesaro convergence. So we have an average of things that goes to zero. Unfortunately, it doesn't say, we would like to say that all the individual things go to zero, but this is not true. Maybe you have seen examples where you have a sequence whose Cesaro averages goes to zero, but the sequence doesn't converge. But still, because we have, here we have non-negative quantities, if I have an average of non-negative quantities that goes to zero, it's still true that most of them must be small. So very often, this is a completely equivalent rephrasing of the Schneeermann theorem, that I can extract the subsequence of density 1 for which the convergence holds true. So along this subsequence S of density 1, it is true that so I can also write this in terms of weak convergence. It is true that the probability measure of density psi k of h squared converges to the uniform measure. And maybe let me show. So for instance, so these are 3 billiards for which the ergodicity theorem is known to hold. The first one is called a Sinai billiard, so it's a square with convex obstacles. This is the stadium billiard and the cardioid billiard. And you can see on the pictures by Anne Baker, you can see quite good illustration of the theorem, that if you plot a large number of eigenfunctions of the Laplacian. Most of them give, maybe I should have said that the places where you have a dark color are the places where psi is large, and the white places is the places where psi is small. So you can see that for most of them, you get rather uniform shade. However, because the theorem only tells you something about subsequence of density one, it is not forbidden to have a few sparse eigenfunctions with a non-uniform behavior. So the theorem is really about the existence of a majority of eigenfunctions that are uniform. So for the moment, I didn't mention any pseudo-differential operators, but it turns out, so in the statement here, there are no pseudo-differential operators, but it turns out that if we want to prove the theorem, we need to prove a more general version. I don't know any way of proving the theorem without proving this more complicated version. So we need to use phase space analysis. In other words, we need to use a test, we need to generalize the statement to test functions A that are not only functions of position, but that are functions of position and momentum. So we need to work on the classical phase space. So it's called the cotangent space. It's the set of pairs, position, and momentum. So position X is a point in the manifold, and psi, the momentum, is a point in the cotangent space. And as we saw in the previous talk, and I think we will see also this afternoon, when you have a reasonable function on phase space, one, it's a basic idea of quantum mechanics, that this is a classical observable, but one can transform it into an operator, so a quantum observable, by replacing the momentum by 1 over I d over dx. And to do that, it's not obvious. One needs to give a formula. One needs also to say what is a reasonable function. So this is the symbol classes that we already saw this morning. But so here I will consider the class S0 functions. In fact, I will need functions that are homogeneous of order 0 with respect to psi. And for such functions, one gets a bounded operator, and one can consider the bracket psi k, a of x dx, psi k. We note that if a doesn't depend on momentum, we are back. So if a doesn't depend on momentum, then we are just multiplying psi by a and taking the bracket with psi. So we are back to the integral of a psi k squared. So this is a generalization of what we saw of the previous quantity. And the full statement of the Schneerman theorem is the following. Again, we are assuming that the geodesic flow is ergodic. We take a test function a of x psi in the class S0. And then the statement is that for most eigenfunctions, then the bracket psi k a of x dx psi k will approach the uniform average of a. It's uniform not only with respect to position, but also with respect to momentum. And this is what we will prove tomorrow. Again, looking at this picture, one can wonder about these exceptional eigenfunctions. They seem to, if you plot eigenfunctions with arbitrary large frequency, they seem to exist for this billiard, they seem to exist for arbitrarily large frequency. But it turns out to be really hard to prove. About a little more than 10 years ago, Andrew Hassel more or less proved it. More precisely, what he proved is that for almost every stadium billiard, then there exists a sequence of eigenfunctions that are not that are not uniformly distributed. And almost every stadium billiard means that actually there is not a single stadium billiard. You can vary the length of the rectangle. So you can, it's a one-parameter family of billiards, and you can put the Lebesgue measure on it. And he proved that for almost every such billiard, although the Schneerman theorem holds true, that there is also an exceptional sequence of eigenfunctions. And that brings me to the last slides of my talk about the quantum unique ergodicity conjecture. The quantum unique ergodicity conjecture was formulated by Rudnick and Sarnak in 92, 94, and it's about negatively curved manifolds. So as I said, it's the maybe nicest form of a chaotic system. There is no boundary, and the dynamics is uniformly hyperbolic. What they conjectured is that what we see on the stadium billiard should not happen on a negatively curved manifold, namely, one should have convergence to the uniform measure for the whole, for the complete sequence of eigenfunctions. So their motivation, Rudnick and Sarnak mostly work on in analytic number theory, so their motivation really came from a very special class of negatively curved manifolds that are called arithmetic surfaces. And I'm not going to describe a lot about this, but let me just say that for these arithmetic surfaces, in addition to the Laplacian, you have what are called Hecke operators, so it's a family of periodic Laplacians, they all commute, so you can decide to consider joint eigenfunctions of all these operators, and it turns out that for these special eigenfunctions, you can reformulate part of the problem, instead of using PDE, you can use analytic number theory. And that was their main motivation for formulating the conjecture, and actually in this arithmetic form, it was proven by Elon Lindenstrauss maybe 2000 something. And so this is called arithmetic quantum unique ergodicity. And in the full form, so in the general form, if you are just on a negatively curved manifold that has no arithmetic property, that has variable curvature, the conjecture is open, but there are two main results. One of them is the one I proved some time ago with Stéphane Nonnenmacher, and it says the following. So let's consider, as before, the bracket psi k, a psi k. We can always, by an abstract compactness argument, we can always assume, because it's a bounded sequence, so we can always assume that it converges to something, and this something has to be of the form, the integral of a, along some unknown measure mu. And the quantum unique ergodicity conjecture is precisely to show that mu has to be the Lebesgue measure. But in general, we don't know how to prove this. What we could prove with Stéphane is that the measure mu has a non-vanishing Kolmogorov-Sinai entropy, which is a special notion entropy that exists in ergodic theory. So in particular, I'm not going to lecture on this, but this means in particular that it's not possible to have a sequence of eigenfunctions on a negatively curved manifold, to have a sequence of eigenfunctions that concentrates when the frequency goes to infinity, that concentrates to one closed geodesic. This is a corollary of our result. And more generally, in constant negative curvature, what we could prove is that the dimension of the support of mu must be at least the dimension of M, the dimension of the manifold M. So it's a kind of weak way of saying that the measure cannot concentrate on a set that is too small. And 2 years ago, there was another advance by Semyon Dyatlov and Jin. So it's for dimension two and constant negative curvature that would prove that the measure mu that you get must have full support, so it has a positive measure on any open set. So it's also not possible to make a sequence of eigenfunctions that asymptotically vanishes on an open set. I mean, vanishes in the sense that the measure psi of h squared gives zero mass at the limit. And this is what is currently known on the quantum unique ergodicity conjecture, and my time is up, and it's my last slide, so
Thinking of it, if you didn't register.